for Armada FC. Your captain, number 9, Kieran Kilda. Number 1, Brian Holt. Number 3, Michael Melvin. Number 4, Meshach Jerome. Number 5, Shane McNeary. Number 20, Wesley Sharpie. Number 10, J.C. Banks. Number 11, Connor Doyle. Number 27, Derek Gebhardt. Number 24, Yuma. And number 7, Joshua Castellanos. Holding the U.S. flag are members from the Mackenzie Noel Wilson Foundation. The Mackenzie Noel Wilson Foundation helps young people recognize their full potential through its local and global programs. Locally, they serve over 300 kids through educational intervention and mentoring. The foundation was created in loving memory of Mackenzie Noel Wilson, a local student who passed away in 2010. To learn more, visit caregivegrow.org. Now, ladies and gentlemen, please stand and remove your hats for the singing of our national anthem by Kelby Corbin and Cassidy Kinsman of Southern Sass. They are national recording artists and Jacksonville natives.
And we welcome you to Hodges Stadium for the regular season finale in the NPSL between the Jacksonville Armada and Naples United FC. There is plenty on the line for the Armada. A chance to be the first seed, the second seed, or maybe the third seed in the NPSL Sunshine Conference playoffs. The Armada have already clinched a playoff spot, but we'll see how it all plays out tonight. A win. And they'll host a playoff game. We don't know yet when and against whom, but the Armada, who will be going to the playoffs for the first time in club history, will know more about their plans after tonight. Mauricio Ruiz joins us, and Mauricio, this has been the end of a long stretch here for the Armada. If you think about games in days, a lot of turnarounds of Wednesdays and Saturdays. And here they are at the end of what is a shorter season than usual, by and large. How have things played out in your mind for the Armada in the NPSL as they close out the regular year?
Well, I think they want to be, they are exactly where they want to be. They want to be in a playoff contention team. They want to be opportunity to host the game, and exactly what they have at stake tonight. You win tonight, you host on Wednesday, even though most likely be a second seed. But you still have an opportunity to go and claim a championship in this league, in this division, and continue the season, as you mentioned, is a shorter season. So we talked often, it's about getting as many games as possible for these players.
For the Armada, here is how it all plays out. If the Armada win and Miami FC loses against Boca Raton, Jacksonville would be the number one seed and would host the winner of Miami FC versus Miami United coming up on Wednesday. If the Armada win and Miami FC wins, which right now they are leading Boca Raton 2-0 in the 17th minute, so we'll keep an eye on that match, then Jacksonville would be the number two seed and would host Miami United on Wednesday. The Armada have beaten Miami FC this year. They have not beaten Miami United. A loss and a couple of draws. You kind of get the sense that the Armada would like to take care of business against Miami United, get that one out of the way in any regard. But they want to close out the regular season strong with a win here today. And the smoke bombs have been set off by Section 904. And you can see how that's wafting before kickoff.
Yeah, and that's exactly right. Even though Miami United is most likely the opponent that they'll see here at Hodges Stadium on Wednesday night in the first round of the playoffs, they want to finish the regular season on a good note, and they want to go into that game with good momentum, with a good result behind their belt. But not only that, Cole, June 30th has to be on this club's mind as it's the last time that they faced Naples United and down there in Naples, and they came back with a loss, with a 1-0 loss. So they want to revenge that game as well, also going into Wednesday on a good momentum.
Naples comes in 5 wins, 1 draw, 5 losses this year. They are locked into fourth place. They'll wear the light blue kits, the Armada in the dark blue, as we get set to get underway here at Hodges Stadium on the UNF campus. The Armada begin 6 wins, 3 draws, and just the 2 defeats, including 1 to Naples United. They are 3rd in the Sunshine Conference. As we begin things here at Hodges Stadium, with the shadows starting to creep across the pitch on this 7:30 kickoff here in Jacksonville. Yuma wins a header for the Armada, cleared out by Naples United. The Armada going with a lineup that includes Wes Sharpie playing a right wing position, J.C. Banks on the left wing. A 3-5-2 formation for the Armada, more or less, but it will morph and change based on defending or attacking. Here's Connor Doyle playing it back for Mikey Melvin, who's coming well forward. So Melvin playing on one wing, Sharpie on the other, and we see Kieran Kilduff and Derek Gebhardt both playing pretty far forward, as is Connor Doyle right now for Jacksonville, as Yuma clears it high into the sun. Sharpie, or rather Gebhardt, tries to fight for position, and Lucas Neck is able to get in there and take it away for Naples United.
Yeah, and what I like about this Armada lineup right now is you have Derek Gebhardt with Kilduff up top. We've seen a different combination of times, whether it's Portilla or Castellanos playing underneath Kilduff. Now you have the speedster young Gebhardt playing right off of him and creating opportunities.
When the Armada faced Naples on June the 30th, the game you mentioned, Mauricio, it was Jonathan Moyano who scored a 75th-minute goal that was the difference maker for Naples United. In their last 5 matches, Naples has 3 wins and 2 losses. The Armada, 3 wins, a draw, and a loss in that stretch. In those last 5 matches, though, for the Armada, they've scored 14 goals and conceded just 3. So the attack has been, by and large, very good. 7 of those goals coming in 1 game against Boca Raton. Meshack Jerome at the back, playing it forward. Over the top for Kilduff. Offside flag is down. Here's Kilduff, the Irish captain. Knocks one off the gloves of the goalkeeper, Blanco, who comes off his line and has to pounce back on it to cover it up for Naples United.
Yeah, and that's a look. That's a good look for Kilduff. He typically plays centrally with his back to the goal, trying to play off of someone. Now he's looking for the ball over the top a little bit. Good clean touch, gets a shot on goal. It's a good start for him. He comes off a 2-goal game against the Storm FC this past week. So it's good to see Kilduff on the scoreboard, and there's nothing better, Cole, than to get your center forward high scoring goals. Confidence is booming at this point.
Both J.C. Banks and Kilduff with braces against Storm in the last meeting. A very comfortable 4-0 win for Jacksonville. It's played forward, and David Walter coming to it. Now Eric Bonilla for Naples United. In the middle of the park, this is Franco Leonhardt. João Correa is the captain for Naples United. We'll see him playing a holding midfield position. And a little bit of a delayed whistle there after Mitchell Tobin tried to streak through.
And Naples seems like a very mature, confident team in their approach. They're not going to get rattled by their Armada. They're not going to get outside of their comfort zone. They know how to play. I wonder, looking at their bench, the depth chart, did they travel with all their players? Do they have enough? You mentioned a 7:30 kickoff. It does definitely helps a little bit with the heat, as most of the field's covered with a shadow right now. But nonetheless, when you play against a 3-5-2, and oftentimes turns into really a 3-3-4, I believe, with their Armada. There's so many numbers forward. Can you sustain that pressure the entire game and chasing the ball as much as Naples will do at times?
Yeah, on the game sheet that we were handed, three substitutes with numbers listed. There are other subs that no numbers assigned at this point. At least it wasn't a couple of minutes before the start of kickoff. So we'll keep an eye on the kind of depth that Naples may or may not have as this game progresses. Here's Meshack Jerome. The Haitian plays one ahead for Wes Sharpie. Sharpie on the run. Working down the wing. Danny Tenorio. Closing him down. And Christian Blanco, the goalkeeper, will easily handle this one. This Naples side has a couple of good goal scorers this year. Both Moyano and Tenorio have scored 5 goals. The rest of the roster combined has scored only 6. They've scored just 16 all year long.
So their minor really shouldn't be surprised where the offensive production for Naples should come out. And you see Moyano's playing more central as a true forward, where Tenorio's playing as a left winger. Well, often that's a trouble position for their minor to deal with, because Wesley Sharpie, he defends as a right back, but he attacks as a right wing back. So Meshack Jerome has to switch across and cover that side. So if that switch doesn't happen quickly enough, you have Speedy Tenorio playing as a left winger there.
Played across by Mitchell Tobin. Gebhardt battling for it. And a foul on Sharpie. See a lot of international jerseys and shirts in the crowd today here at Hodges Stadium, including a few for the Three Lions. Some folks wearing the shirt of the English soccer team that has advanced to the semifinals.
Oh, they're coming out happier now, aren't they?
Don't see a lot of Brazil out there.
No. We've put that one away. There's always 2022.
What a World Cup it has been.
It really has been, Cole. I mean, if you're just a fan and you're a lover of the game, it's had everything. It's had beautiful goals. It's had good style of play, good defensive style teams that are getting away with wins just by being compact and disciplined. And man, how many controversies have there been?
Own goals all over the place. Yeah,
there's a record of 14 own goals in World Cup or something like that.
Yeah, I know it's a record. I'm not sure of the number, but well over 11 at least. Here's Gebhardt now feeding it through. And Castellanos, who I spoke with this week in practice, the former UNF star, and he is so excited about the possibility of having a Armada playoff game here at Hodges Stadium. When he finished his career at UNF, he didn't know if he'd ever play on this pitch again. And I was asking him, hey, when you think back to what happened, when you learned that there was going to be a pro soccer team in Jacksonville again, what did you think? He said, well, I even go back thinking about the Jacksonville Destroyers and how excited I was to think one day I could play for the Destroyers. And here he is playing for the Armada. Yuma taking the short corner, sets it up for Connor Doyle. He swings one in. Kilduff tried to get a boot to it. And it's cleared out all the way back to Mikey Melvin.
Yeah, I think Coach Lari, as a good Englishman, is want to make sure that they're well set up on the set pieces.
Kilduff went for the header. Went all the way through. Doyle tried to get it back to Castellanos. Cleared out for the moment by Naples. The Armada have had the bulk of possession here in the early minutes. Kilduff a header. Sets it back. Castellanos. And hit it on the upslope there and just didn't let the ball fall back to his foot. But good idea by Kilduff trying to set up the midfielder.
And that's why Gebhardt and Castellanos have to be super alert, because Kilduff's going to continue to do that. He's always going to bat on there. I think referee called an early foul on him. But that's going to continue to happen all game long. Services from out wide, from Meshack Jerome, from Mikey Melvin, into cutoffs. He holds off players so well. He knows exactly what he's doing. And those little underneath layoffs to Castellanos and Gebhardt. See, Castellanos not getting a whole lot of it on that one.
Second ball handled by Doyle. There is a player down for Naples United. They play on at this point. Castellanos gets tripped up. Now out wide for Sharpie, but it was cut off by Lucas Neckes, who will play it out, and they'll go back and take a look at the Naples player who's down on the deck. Danny Tenorio having a word with Matthew Schwartz, the referee in the center of the field. They'll bring the trainer on to take a look at this down Naples player. Again, we mentioned very limited in terms of depth on the bench right now for Naples United. That appears to be Jose Valverdes.
Yeah, number three left back.
Update from Miami, by the way. Miami with a 2-0 lead at the half-hour mark over Boca Raton. Remember, the Armada need a win here and for Boca Raton to pull the upset on Miami FC in order to take the top seed. The benefit of having the top seed over the number two seed is you get a little extra rest. The 2 and 3 seeds will play on Wednesday, and then the winner of that one will take on the top seed on Saturday.
Right, so the Armada has some, their faith is in their hands in a sense of hosting that first game, because if you are going to be the two, if you are going to play on Wednesday, you want to make sure that you're playing at home. In the Hodges Stadium, where Armada is still undefeated this season, so it's really important. Even though they haven't beat Miami United, they have not lost at home, and with the good momentum from this game, securing that win, it only spells good thoughts and good vibes going into Wednesday.
And remember, the loss in the U.S. Open Cup for the Armada to Miami United came at JU rather than here at Hodges Stadium. Throw in for Jacksonville. Headed away, Yuma keeps it for the Armada. Now a blast from Meshack Jerome. A little ambitious, but had some smoke behind it. Goal kick coming for Naples United.
I think that made Blanco think just for a second. The ball just kept drifting away, but we've seen Jerome time and time again having the ability to shoot from distance. So not a bad take from him. Yeah. You talk about some of the records or some of the interesting, fun things in the World Cup, Cole. How many goals were scored in extra time this year in the World Cup?
Yep.
More than ever. So I think it speaks to players' fitness. It speaks to the heart of the World Cup, never giving up, and how tight the games are with small nations of 4 million playing against nations of over 100 million population. I think it's incredible. It's been an absolutely exhilarating, thrilling World Cup.
I think we talked about the population of Iceland being somewhere in the 350,000 range.
Right.
And a foul detected on Eric Bonilla for Naples United. It'll be possession back to Jacksonville. And when you think about that, that's about half the population of Duval County. Here's Kilduff. And while you're dealing with the recent sorrow of Brazil's loss, the U.S. didn't make it in. It makes it all the more difficult to, when you think, boy, what could the United States have done in a very balanced World Cup this year?
Well, and I think they would have been very competitive.
Gebhardt, can he get to it?
It's oftentimes what kind of group you come out of, or how you line up in the quarterfinals. But I think the U.S. would have been extremely competitive.
England has certainly benefited from a good draw.
They benefited from finishing second place in their group, right?
That's right. The loss to Belgium basically made things paved an easier way. That being said, England has looked very good.
Right. Well, they had to get through a tough Colombian team that by the time they played them, they were a little, they weren't a full force with James. They looked a little bit different.
Mm-hmm.
But nonetheless, it's still exciting game. England had in the bag in the 93rd minute, center back, leading goal scorer for Colombia this year, in the World Cup, 3 goals, 3 games. Russia today tying it in overtime.
Mikey Melvin lost a boot. I'll have to put it back on. Yeah, you talk about some of the amazing finishes. You have Croatia having advanced to the semifinals with back-to-back shootout wins. Had to go to penalty kicks each of their last two matches.
Right, and it's a team that one of the only two teams that won all three stage games, and everyone was hyping about them. And you know, if it's Denmark and Russia, not necessarily the two toughest opponents that they had to face, and it takes them two shootouts to win the game.
A counter opportunity for Naples. Moyano cut off by Meshack Jerome. Moyano tried to run through Jerome. Not a good idea. And then Moyano took exception to Jerome's defending. I don't think Meshack is the guy I would be picking out of the entire Armada 11 to try to pick a fight with.
No, and there's really nothing wrong with that. Meshack just gave him a little shoulder check right as he's going out of bounds. Moyano really doesn't have any reason to get up and get in his face. You know, what I want to see from the Armada is a lot of what we talked about last couple of weeks. They have to start the game with a lot of energy. If they start slow and they're trying to track the team to come to them, they have a tendency to give up silly errors in the back. When they start with high speed, with high energy, really kind of get into goal, we've seen them get on the scoreboard first.
There's Connor Doyle getting the shove from behind by Franco Leonhardt. Naples has come out playing physically here in the opening 15 minutes. So far, though, the ball has been at the feet of the Armada players more often than not. There's Castellanos getting kicked and going down.
It's just a sloppy game right now. Not a whole lot of flow to it.
Quick restart for Jacksonville. Here's Sharpie looking to cross one in. Gebhard just mishit a header on a wide open net. Missed opportunity for the Armada. Then Yuma got the shoulder put into him by Danny Tenorio, who comes back and has a word for the Spaniard. Yuma not one to back down.
Yeah, and Naples has to be careful here. As we mentioned, their lack of depth on the bench for them right now. Armada have plenty of options, and you don't want to do anything silly. You've seen Moyano get up on Mishak's face. Now you've seen Tenorio get up on Yuma's face. Armada players are very veteran-like players. They're going to instigate. They're gonna do just enough to not get caution. But can we go back and talk about that miss by Derek Gebhardt?
Here's Jerome slamming one across the ground from probably just outside the Jerome zone, but it went all the way through for a goal kick.
Quick heads-up play, short free kick. Great runs inside the box by Kildoff and Gebhardt. And Gebhardt had the wide-open goal to just put it in. Easy job, finish it up, and the ball just comes off the side of his head. Good opportunity for the Armada. They seem to start to put in a little bit of pressure on this Naples United team.
We mentioned Naples has scored just 16 goals all season. They have conceded only 13, so they have been more likely to be involved in low-scoring matches. That's been the way that they've played. This one over the top. Here's Gebhardt on the run out. Gebhardt, can he settle it? He cannot. He was cut off by Leonhardt, who was tracking back.
Well, you can see why Gebhardt's playing up top, and you know they've tried to attempt a couple balls over the top. He's got the speed to be this very stingy, physical back line for Naples United. Wasn't able to continue on that header down. The ball just held up on him just a little bit. But that's a good look. I love the flexibility in the game plan for their Armada right now. They're not just knocking it around without a purpose, which seems like at times, which is not, because they're trying to track the other team to come out. But why not use Castellanos over the top, use Gebhardt over the top a few times, stretch that Naples United team out.
Another goal scored in Miami by Dario Suarez, his second of the match. Miami FC a 3-0 lead in the 39th minute over Boca Raton, so things not going the way the Armada would need it for that top seed. I don't think anybody was anticipating that Boca Raton would beat Miami today. It was more of a hopeful situation for the Armada, but at this point, Miami FC appears to be taking care of business. Here's Gebhardt again for Castellanos, who let it come all the way through to him and almost got out of the box, and then Yuma thought to the better of it, but it was too late after sending that one wide.
Yeah, not really Yuma's strength. I mean, he's a possession guy. He moves the game side to side. I think we've yet to see him from top of the box. Crack went out. Good play from Gebhardt and Castellanos, trying to get something inside the box. Gebhardt really successful out wide, not necessarily finishing one of his strengths, but man, making people miss and getting to the end line and hitting the ball back.
Yuma heads this one forward for Kilduff. Now to Gebhardt. He's got Banks coming on the left. J.C. Banks scored two on Wednesday night to celebrate the 4th of July. That was an over-the-top Shane McInerney there for Jacksonville.
McInerney has just grown as a player in the last couple of games, hasn't he, Cole? He just came in. We saw his debut here at home, a little bit shaky. But, yeah. Man, he's become a leader back there, very reliable.
Really seems to have settled into the role and the way that those three defenders are playing for the Armada. In particular with he and Meshack Jerome, I think, really getting on the same page.
Right.
Here's Mikey Melvin sending one forward for Banks, but it took a high hop, and Banks couldn't get a foot to it. Throw in for Naples United. The one interesting note on Naples from this year that really stands out, the last place team in the Sunshine Conference is Storm FC, who have scored just one goal all year long. It came against Naples United, and it was an own goal. So Naples United scored more goals for Storm than Storm did this year. Rough year for Storm FC.
Rough year for Storm FC, yeah. Not a year that they're going to want to remember. And see, there's Meshack Jerome just taking his eye off the ball, rolling underneath his foot. Those are the silly giveaways that we talk about that we have seen result into counterattack goals, opportunities for the opposition against the Armada. While that's also their strength, and they get teams to run around a lot, they've missed on those marks also.
Throw in for Naples. Meshack got ahead to it, then Yuma able to send it forward. Gebhardt didn't get much on the header there. Sharpie battling forward along with Tenorio. Throw in for Naples United. With this being the last regular season match of the year, you start thinking about who you might vote for certain awards for the Armada. MVP might be a tough choice this year for Jacksonville. There have been a number of guys who have performed very well. Kilduff, Banks, Yuma, Meshack.
Yeah, I think when you look at an award like that, you have to think about if you were to remove that player from the team, which player would the Armada feel the miss the most?
Well, you can make a case for Yuma. You can make a case for Kilduff. You can make a case for Meshack, I think.
Really
there, very easily.
Absolutely.
Not to take anything away from J.C. Banks, who's played very well.
Or even Brian Holt.
Yep.
You know, he's allowed the team to play in the possession style that they want to play. He's made the saves when he had to make saves.
Three of the last five matches, clean sheets for Holt. Now here's Gebhardt on the run out and cut off. It'll be a corner kick coming for Jacksonville.
I really love what they're Armada doing right now, Cole. Kildoff is actually the one that's coming in the slot and then at that attacking midfield position. Castellanos just keeping himself a little bit off the play, off the shoulders of the holding mid. Kildoff a little bit better with his back to the goal, better in possession, allowing Gebhardt just to stretch out that defense, just get in behind. He hasn't found the back of the net or a shot on goal yet, but just a matter of time until he sees himself just facing up the goalkeeper.
Yuma's going to go over to take the corner. Connor Doyle is in the neighborhood as well. You see over there on the right of your screen. Last time they went short to Connor.
And you see McInerney on Blanco, the goalkeeper. He's just going to make that near post run. Try to get a little flick there if he can. Guys on top of the box just making aggressive runs.
Doyle tried to send it in. Cleared out by Naples. And now here's Gebhardt again. Put it on the ground. Blanco able to cover it. Didn't have to move far on that low shot from Gebhardt.
That's a good heads-up play by Derek Gebhardt. Getting the knockdown after Meshack Jerome's shot. Connected well with it. Just didn't have a whole lot of direction. An easy save for Blanco.
Gebhardt's had a couple looks. Has not been able to find the back of the net. Two goals this year for Gebhardt, but he's created some very good opportunities with his pace. Here's Castellanos.
Well, he just makes the team, the opposition, a team like Naples United, ask some questions of themselves. Do we press up against Kildoff when he checks into the slot? Do we stay honest because we know Gebhardt can threaten with speed? Every time you have speed on the field on that high line, it just makes the opposition have to ask some questions on how do you deal with those runs.
Kildoff coming deep for it.
Yeah, and this is what I'm talking about. Kildoff just coming. We haven't really seen this tactic from the Armada. Kildoff is typically the last line.
And then here's the ball over the top for Kildoff. Got his head to it, then taken down on the edge of the box. And they're going to call a foul on Kildoff here. Kieran little surprised at that decision by Matthew Schwartz. I thought the decision might be in or out of the box, but instead, foul on the Armada captain.
Yeah, I think Robson actually had good position on the ball, and Kildoff was trying to get around him a little bit. I'm not sure if there was a foul either way, just a good aggressive play. But he felt that Kildoff used a little bit too much of his arms.
Think about the run that Kildoff made, though.
Oh, absolutely. Just a lot of movement from him. And we talk about his movement and his unselfish movement all season long. About time to tie your boots there, McInerney.
Yeah, McInerney went down to put his shoe back on, and next thing you know, the ball's coming back to him. Here's Meshack Jerome. Long pass along the ground. Castellanos playing it forward. Gebhardt on the run. He's got Kildoff to his left. Gebhardt on the run, pushed down. And that's going to be a PK.
And I'm not really sure.
Might be a handball call.
What Schwartz is referencing for a handball. That was a takedown. If the ball eventually hit his hand, that's a side effect of a takedown. Derek Gebhardt, I think he finally realized how fast he is. He looked inside the box and he said, this is mine. Pushed it past the defender, and it was absolutely takedown. I'm not sure if Schwartz called the foul or the handball. But either way, a well-deserved PK for the Armada here.
Yeah, earned by Derek Gebhardt. It'll be taken by Kieran Kildoff.
Well, you just mentioned how many times Gebhardt, how active he has been. Just hadn't really found the back of the net yet, but he just keeps asking those questions of Naples United, and that's how you answer sometimes against a fast player.
Including U.S. Open Cup play, Kieran Kildoff has scored 6 goals for the Armada this year. And it's saved by Blanco on a ball that didn't have a lot of speed behind it. And Blanco guessed right and then covered it up. Oh, another missed opportunity. The Armada have had 2 very good looks at the goal here in the opening 25 minutes and cannot convert.
Yeah, and that's a well-guessed PK save from Blanco. Not awfully taken by Kildoff. If Blanco dies the other way, we're not talking about whether it was a soft or strong, but did not make Blanco move too much. And Kildoff is going to want that one back, Cole, because that would have been a deserving goal for the Armada at this stage in the game. Against a Naples United defense, that goals don't come around very often.
I'll mark it down in the 26th minute, the opportunity on the PK. We'll see if that comes back to be a factor. Here's Bonilla on a run out into the box. Cuts it back in. Holt comes off his line. Saved by Holt with a foot, who also had some help. Now a giveaway by Yuma, and finally cleared out by Meshack Jerome. Oh, boy, what a minute that could have been for the Armada. From a PK opportunity, and then almost, after missing that, giving up a goal there. Now a little flick-on header from Kildoff. Connor Doyle tries to chip the keeper, but Blanco was backing up, and Doyle might want that one back. After looking up, he saw that neon yellow jersey coming off the line, but Blanco was retracing his steps as Doyle went to try to boot it over him.
But it's a good bit of back-and-forth soccer game here at Hodges Stadium tonight. Miss PK, foot save by Brian Holden at the other end. And then another counterattack for the Armada. Good back and forth, but you can see how missed chances can lead into opportunities for the other team. Armada almost saw themselves down 1-0 after a missed PK. What a great save by Brian Holt, huh?
As we mentioned, Holt with 3 last 5 matches, clean sheets. And not all clean sheets are the same. Some matches you certainly see a goalkeeper under more pressure than otherwise, but Holt's made some crucial saves at key moments this year for Jacksonville, the former New York Cosmos backup keeper who found his way to Jacksonville this year.
And you see the referee talking there to Tenorio again. Tenorio just has to rise above it because that last play was a beautiful ball. He's finding himself a little bit more in the midfield. He drew some attention. Beautiful ball down to Bonilla, which did a lot with that. And Tenorio just seems to be talking to – he's more interested in talking to the ref tonight than playing because when he decides to play, Cole – he's a player you have to be careful with.
Castellanos down on the deck. And now back up. Yuma getting set to take this restart for Jacksonville. Sent in Banks got the bottom of his foot to it. Headed back by Yuma, then Kilduff. Kilduff again. McInerney sets it up for Castellanos. Castellanos got it across the front of the goal as he was being ridden out there by Gorobsov. Decent opportunity there for Jacksonville.
Yeah, after a couple ping-pong balls back and forth inside the box, Castellanos so quick around the corner, does a really good job of just pushing the ball, heading that down past the defender, but not enough people in the box as the ball just ran right across Blanco's goal.
Now here's Tenorio. He and Connor Doyle get tied up.
Tenorio's trying to find a lot of the game. He's starting position is that left wing position, but he's starting to come inside and find the game a little bit. You see the quality that he has. And Doyle definitely bumped him a little bit. Definitely a foul.
I'm not sure if Tenorio has been watching Neymar a lot lately.
It's the effect, unfortunately.
He has been embroiled in quite a bit of the activity today, and now they're going to call a trainer over. The ref says, bring the trainer. Tenorio's teammate says, forget about it. Referee Matthew Schwartz says, nope, bring him on.
Well, you're going to stay on the ground for that long, and then it means you need medical attention. If not, you're able to get up and go.
It's the Armada sending the trainer, Alex Witter, over there.
And obviously his teammates don't want the trainer to come on because that means Tenorio has to come off the field once the trainer enters the field.
You can see Lucas Nekas, the big fullback there, was saying, no, stay off, stay off. Now Tenorio being told by the referee, Matthew Schwartz, time to go off. He'll come back on shortly. That is part of the give and take when you go down and stay down, whether for good reason or no. And the referee makes the decision that a trainer comes on. It means you got to come off for at least a moment.
So, and it does seem that FIFA is looking at, you know, what you're talking about goal line technology in the last World Cup, you know, VAR this World Cup. There's going to have to be a point that they figure out how to deal with embellishment. And I know that's very subjective at times. But there's got to be a way to deal with that embellishment, that the referee is going to have some discrepancy and some latitude on how to deal with players diving, rolling, delay of game as well. I think those are one of the ugly things that, the truest of the games, the historians of the game, say, well, that's how the game is played. Well, I think we're past that point. I think the game has evolved. Every other sport has evolved in the world. And soccer has finally shown its ability to evolve with technology.
And when it happens on the biggest stage with one of the biggest stars, with Neymar
right,
and the World Cup in particular, it's going to get a lot more attention. Here's Kilduff, able to ward off a defender, keep it in along the touchline. Yuma got kicked as he came to it. Castellanos continues his hard work. Castellanos' fitness this year has been something to behold. Here comes the former UNF Osprey. Castellanos leaves it off for Gebhard. A little too close together, perhaps, but it'll be a corner kick for Jacksonville. Castellanos and Gebhard weren't quite on the same page on that attack.
Well, I mean, what a lovely run by Castellanos, just breaking through, using his speed and quickness, and he did wind up for a shot, but it was a right play. Gebhard's coming in on the PK spot. I don't know if he wasn't expecting it or he was looking for the rebound off of the shot, but he's got to be ready to take that first time call. It's a lovely ball across from Castellanos. Keeper, he's blocking Castellanos' angle for a shot. Castellanos plays that across. Gebhard has the back post wide open. He's got to be ready for that.
Connor Doyle for the corner for Jacksonville. Third one of the game. Castellanos coming close.
And Naples United chooses to only send one player out there.
Doyle sends it to the top of the 6-yard box, headed away by the Naples defense. Now a counter opportunity for Naples United. On the run, here's Bonilla. He's got a man to his right, Tobin. Tobin into the box, cuts it back against Mikey Melvin. Now from well outside of the box, way over hit on a ball that never threatened the goal. by Garamsov.
Well, that's a good counterattack for Naples United. You can see their speed on the counter. Armada does a good job of getting behind the ball, but Tenorio's not happy right now. He was wide open on the first counter. Then when the ball finally found Tobin, he was still wide open. An early service would have really complicated things for Brian Holding goal.
One of the things that Mark Lowry has been preaching for his team to get early goals. Well, we've gone well past the half-hour mark, and the Armada had two great chances and a couple of half chances, but haven't been able to find the score sheet as of yet.
Yeah, chances have not been an issue. Armada have keep creating a whole lot of them. You know, I mentioned I really like what they're doing with Kildoff coming in and getting the ball and keeping Gebhardt higher. It's creating chances. However, Kildoff is a better finisher out of the two. So now you have your best finisher outside of the box, and you have someone that creates chances, but not necessarily, as we saw on the play before. Derek Gebhardt is not a straight-out center forward. So he's got a difficult time inside the box where he's so effective out wide, just making people miss. So it's a bit of a give and take there. You control more of the ball. You create more chances. You just hope that one of them are gonna go in for you.
And sometimes it's that delicate balance for a coach. Do you create a system that really plays to the strength of one player, or do you create a system that may play to a particular style or strength of a group of players, but one of those players might be asked to do something not quite in his wheelhouse? Now here's Sharpie, all the way to the byline, cuts it back, Gebhardt, a little hesitant on as he had a defender coming in from behind. Gebhardt looks a little shell-shocked right now.
I think he does. He's seen so many opportunities inside the box where it's not natural for him. I mean, we're here talking about the last game of the season, and it's the first time that we've seen him at Hodges Stadium playing that in that central role. So he hasn't gotten a whole lot of minutes, a lot of rotations up there. He's been very comfortable playing at really a wide left for the Armada, cutting in on his right for shots or just picking up, you know, any loose balls in the box. Centrally, that's just not his comfort zone. But once again, he's there. He's creating chances. It's a matter of time and one of those will eventually go in or bounce off of and create a chance for somebody else.
Tenorio closed down by Sharpie and Connor Doyle. Tenorio a little frustrated and fouled at that point. You can see him just staring down Matthew Schwartz, the referee.
Well, he's just a player that draws a lot of attention to himself. He doesn't lose the ball a whole lot. He's a strong player. So every time he's getting grabbed and being pulled back, he's asking for the foul.
And this is the fourth place team in the Sunshine Conference, and Schwartz will put the ball back, and you can see Tenorio a little nonplussed about it. But when you start talking about two former NASL sides in Miami FC and the Armada in this conference now, it's a long one. Holt with Garabsov bearing down on him, able to get it out of there. But Naples certainly a team with some talent and might be thinking that they're a second-place side had the two NASL teams not joined the conference this year.
Well, absolutely. You can see they're very well disciplined, very well organized in the back line, built well as a team, speedy fullbacks, strong center backs, and some good players up top that can create some really good chances in Bonilla, Tenorio, Moyano.
And you wondered a little bit, they, as a team, arrived much later than we usually see teams arrive at the park, less than an hour before kickoff, and there was no sign of Naples United, but they don't seem to have gotten off with any kind of road rust. I don't know if they drove up tonight or spent the night after a trip up. There's Castellanos in the middle of the park. Out wide now for J.C. Banks. Banks swinging it toward the back post. Gebhardt rising, couldn't get his head to it. Well defended by Naples. And the counter opportunity for Bonilla. Yuma cuts him off. Well done by Yuma to tackle the ball away.
But that's a great tackle, Cole. That's an understated and open field against a quicker attacking player. We know Yuma's not necessarily going to catch up to anyone, so that's a beautiful tackle from him.
Castellanos with a blast that never threatened the goal. Yeah, Yuma, talk about the timing of that tackle. Just measured him and technically, almost surgically, dispossessed him from the ball.
Yeah, he's just a veteran player that he knows how to put his foot in the right place. And not only winning the ball, not only tackling and dispossessing the player, but keeping possession for yourself as well and being able to get a transition offense out of that. Yeah, Connor Doyle trying to shot from distance. Can't get desperate here. A lot of really good opportunities inside the box. When you start lining them up from 35 yards out, that means you're starting to run out of ideas a little bit. Chances are coming. Opportunities are there. You got to continue to stay at it. Coach Lowry has to be happy with how many opportunities that they're getting and really not being threatened over the, you know, on the other side of, you know, too much. Outside of that one counterattack opportunity, yep. It really hasn't really been much that Naples United have threatened their Armada goal.
The lights are on here at Hodges Stadium. The shadows from the grandstand are gone as the sun sets behind the grandstand to the west. Here's David Walter and Bonilla. It'll be a throw-in for Naples.
And see how quickly the Armada 3-5-2 goes back into a back line of four when they defend, with Wesley Sharpie dropping in as a right back.
Taken away by J.C. Banks. Now Kilduff again in a little deeper position.
And then right away, you'll see how far Wesley Sharpie is already playing as a right wing back. It's a beautiful transitional shape from a 3-4-3, what it looks like at times, or 3-5-2 to a 4-4-2. As quickly as they do, it's very impressive.
Really demands fitness as well, particularly out of a guy like Sharpie.
Oh, absolutely.
Offside flag up on the far side.
Yeah, you need very specific personnel to be able to do that. You can't just play the system with whoever. You need guys like J.C. Banks and Sharpie and Castellanos that can play those positions out wide and really do that work back and forth.
Final 5 minutes of regulation time here in the first half. The Armada have had the best chances, but neither side has found a goal. An Armada draw or a loss, and they're the third seed and would have to go on the road to Miami United on Wednesday to open the playoffs. A win, and it guarantees them a home match in the postseason. Probably a Wednesday. Unless Boca Raton turns in one of the great comebacks we've seen of late. Right now it's 4-0 for Miami FC at halftime. Here is J.C. Banks. Beautiful through ball. Melvin crossing toward Kilduff. Got his head to it. Saved by Blanco, who made a terrific diving save there to get his hand on it. Kilduff was in just the right spot for the header.
Yeah, and that really was a beautiful save by Blanco. Even a better header by Kilduff. And you see why it's important to have Kilduff as a centrally inside the box, because he gets the ball on the frame. He makes goalkeepers make saves. But man, what a save from Blanco. Hopefully he is good enough. He didn't hit his head on the crossbar, because he elevated pretty high.
And you can see him indicating something he felt like may have popped out. And they're looking at his left leg.
He must have fallen very, very unorthodox. Just the way his body reached out and grabbed that ball from nearly outside, from inside the goal. I mean, that was a beautiful header, upper 90. He was coming across his box. Referee getting a bit of water there.
Armada fans, if you need any assistance, have questions about your season tickets, or any inquiries related to tonight's experience at this match, please stop by the ticket booth on your way out. Katie would be more than happy to help you out.
Well, this, with a 4-0 halftime lead for Miami, really boils down to this. The Armada win, they get to host a playoff game on Wednesday.
Right, and with the tie, them not hosting it, falling to the number three slot and having to go down to Miami United and play there, you're going to see an Armada team come out in the second half with a bit of a fever, wanting to get this goal, because a tie will feel like a loss tonight, because it's a missed opportunity to host a playoff game.
In particular, with the chances they've already had in the first half that have not been converted upon. Yuma to take the fourth corner for the Armada. McInerney and Kilduff with big bodies right there in the six-yard box, along with Gebhardt.
Got a couple extra guys on top of the box.
Yuma sends it back. Meshack Jerome. Now Yuma. Castellanos with his head up. Again, a little overambitious and not particularly creative there.
Yeah, that's not a bad play. He just landed on the foot of a right-footed player that has a lot of work to do there when he receives that ball. If it's a left-footed player, he can line it up away from pressure and try to hit it, but he's putting the ball back into where he came from.
And look at this. They're going to have Grubsov take the goal kick after Blanco fell and had to get some attention to the leg. So that bears watching as the match continues. Castellanos got it forward for Gebhard, and then Gebhard couldn't maintain possession along the touchline. Throw in for Naples United.
You can see the Croatian goalkeeper today right before overtime. What it seemed to be have tweaked or pulled his hamstring, but Persevere ended up playing the entire game. But at one point, it looked like he needed to come off. They're going to have to burn a substitution on him.
I'm not sure if Naples has another option at goalkeeper right now. We mentioned only three numbered players are listed as their subs, and there are only three guys over there on the bench, and none of them are wearing a goalkeeper's jersey.
Well, I tell you what, right now, the way Blanco's playing, you know, they wouldn't want to go to anybody else, especially if they have to go to field player. But it seems like he's fine. He just needed a couple extra seconds to regain his strength there.
Now Gebhard is spun down. And this may be a card coming for Lucas Nekas. It is. First yellow card of the match. Hold on Nekas in the 45th minute.
Wayne, and that's where Derek Gebhard just continues to be a menace to his back line. You know, we keep referencing that he's not cracking the goal. He's missing those opportunities, but he just challenges the back line with his speed and the fear that he puts into a big guy like Nekas and Grobson. It makes it really a difficult matchup for anyone on the back line, and hopefully frees up some space for Kjeld off and Castellanos making a deep run.
Well, we're into stoppage time now. We have not been made aware of how much stoppage time will be added. Looks like 2 minutes will be added here at the end of the half.
2 minutes have been added to the first half. Official time will be kept by the head referee on the field. Again,
once again, Yuma and Connor Doyle will combine to restart here. Doyle over everybody.
Got too much underneath that one. He's looking for there to get part of the back post to knock it down. Seems like they're about to have a bunch of these little well-orchestrated plays off of set pieces, but they really haven't panned out just yet. We see McNerney get on a lot of them, but the ball hasn't found his head tonight.
When you have a team like the Armada with the quality of veteran players that aren't often found in this league, certainly makes sense that you'd have a lot of opportunities at set pieces with fouls on breakaways like this one. And there's Gebhard taken down just outside the box. Free kick coming for Jacksonville from right at the edge of the 18.
And I'll tell you what, there's an argument for a red card here, Cole, and he wasn't necessarily going in the direction of the goal, but the ball, with that touch, frees him up, and he would have had the second touch going into the box. It was definitely outside. Some of the players are arguing whether it's inside or not. Definitely outside of the box, but there's an argument. If not a red card, there's definitely a yellow card situation.
And it's interesting when you start talking, and now there's the yellow card.
So both center backs on the yellow card now, both from Derek Gebhard using his speed. They're going to have to play off of him just a little bit going forward into the second half.
And Grubsov with the yellow.
There's really no other way to stop him at that point. When you put that ball over the top and he's about to take that touch and explode into space, you have to commit to the ball and the risk of hitting him. Wonder if Coach Lahr is going to have a word with the center referee at halftime, why that wasn't considered as a red card.
Yeah, I think you may be right on the explanation because he wasn't directly going to the goal. It was a ball that was out wide, but it was the last. Grubsov was the last line of defense before the goalkeeper.
Yeah, he's the last man. I think if he was going straight in the direction, which is tough to argue that he wasn't, because his next touch would have been inside. But
now here's the free kick opportunity. Banks and Jerome. Meshack will take it. A blast from Jerome, and it's through. Meshack from the Jerome zone. And the Armada will take a lead into halftime.
Boy, and that's a good-looking free kick, Cole. J.C. Banks just stays on it, just lets Blanco know that he's an option as well. But we knew the entire time, Meshack Jerome, he can strike it from distance. He can strike it from a little bit tighter. And just absolute bullets the ball past the wall, and nothing that Blanco can see. By the time he got to him, the ball's ready behind him and into the net.
Meshack Jerome's first goal of the season for the Armada, and it is vintage Meshack Jerome.
You're right. We used to see him his first season here with the Armada. We've seen him do this a whole lot, whether he got it on frame or make keepers make save. The ball hasn't found the back of the net in a while, but that was absolutely a bullet, a well-earned goal from the Armada, deserving 1-0 lead right now at halftime.
The Armada with all kinds of opportunities in that first half, and Jerome took advantage there. And give credit to Derek Gebhard, who again, talk about the three best chances for Jacksonville as the half comes to an end. Gebhard had a hand in creating all of them, either on the end as a header opportunity or the PK or the free kick, with his pace really creating that chance for Jacksonville. Halftime at Hodges Stadium. The Armada 45 minutes away from hosting a playoff game, thanks to that man, Meshack Jerome, and his first goal of the year. Jacksonville Armada 1, Naples United 0 at halftime.
Don't forget to stop by our guest service and retail area to sign up with our Enter to Win program to win a special prize to be announced at the end of halftime tonight. Is the official office equipment provider of the Jacksonville Armada. We can help your organization with all your copying, printing, and scanning needs. Visit us at copyfacts.com.
Just a young girl with a quick fuse. I was uptight, wanna let loose. I was dreaming of bigger things and wanna leave my old life behind. Not a yes sir, not a follower. Hold out the seat in the foyer, take a number. I was lightning before the thunder.
Thunder.
forget to stop by Delicious Colombianas in Beach Boulevard to watch all the 2018 FIFA World Cup matches. Every Thursday is karaoke night, and every Friday night they have live music with drink specials and delicious Colombian food.
Just about ready to begin the second half here at Hodges Stadium. The Armada up 1-0 on Meshack Jerome's stoppage time laser beam goal. The Armada 45 minutes away from hosting a playoff game here in Jacksonville on Wednesday. It's 4-0 Miami FC leading Boca Raton. But an interesting development in that matchup. In the first minute, coming out of halftime, Jaime Chavez, one of the leading goal scorers for Miami FC, was sent off. So, the Armada, if they were to beat Miami United on Wednesday, could see a shorthanded Miami FC club on Saturday. Right now they're playing a man down, but leading 4-0 over Boca Raton. We're underway in the second half here in Jacksonville. Jerome, a long diagonal ball headed by Kilduff. Banks is over there. Nutmegs a defender, J.C. Banks. Now sends it back for Connor Doyle, who's run off the ball. Tobin able to dispossess Connor Doyle for Naples. Now Tenorio. Mauricio, what do you want to see out of the Armada here in the second half?
Well, it's important that they come out of the locker room with a lot of energy, Cole. They're up 1-0. They can't allow a team in Naples United, which obviously want to come up here and get the result. They're going to change things up a little bit, being down 1-0. They're going to start pressing a little bit higher. But it's important that Armada, they don't make themselves wide open, but also don't take their foot off the pedal here. It's 45 minutes, a capable Naples team that we've seen on counterattacks can be very, very dangerous.
McInerney's header forward. Gebhard couldn't quite get there before it was cut off. Remember, both center backs for Naples United, Lucas Nekas as well as Valentin Garabsov, are on yellow cards as well here. So we'll see how that plays out in the second half. Castellanos ran all the way around Valanderde to get the ball, and then he's kicked. And free kick coming for Jacksonville. That was Nekas, who's already on a yellow card. And Yuma over there asking about the continuation.
Well, absolutely. I'm not sure why he's going all the way back and calling the foul from when he first got knocked. He progressed, and then he finally got knocked down on top of the box. And to your point, if Nekas is not on a yellow card, that's a yellow card. And why that foul is not on top of the box right now, it's beyond me. I think this is referee Matthew Schwartz trying to make a little bit more out of it than what it is. Just call the foul on top of the box, and if it's a yellow card, it's a yellow card.
Here's Connor Doyle on the restart for Jacksonville. He chips it toward the penalty spot, headed away by Garabsov.
A fast start for the Armada. Will be getting a goal in the first 10 minutes of the game of the second half here. Being able to control the game now with a positive scoreline and not allowing Naples United to feel like they have a life. The longer the scoreline stays the way it is, a 1-0, Naples feeling like they can get back in the game with one play, this game could go either way. The next goal is really important for either team.
Brian Holt, the Armada goalkeeper, will play it at his feet. Dmitrijak Jerome calmly to Kilduff, again coming deep. Now here's Connor Doyle coming forward. Doyle, long diagonal. And Blanco came out and stepped in front of J.C. Banks. A risk-reward moment there for Blanco, but he made the right decision as it turned out.
Well, absolutely, because if he doesn't, that's falling in the lap of J.C. Banks with a lot of room in front of him. So Blanco did a pretty good job tonight keeping Naples United in the game.
Sharpie tracking back. As Valadares came on the run, couldn't get to it. Goal kick coming for Jacksonville.
I think that's a problem with, we talked about embellishment and people falling and how referees have to handle that. You know, Valadares definitely fell there. Sharpie takes offense to it, goes over and talks to him. You know, there are situations like that in the game. Referees either have to start carding much sooner, much earlier, having a good talk with them.
There's a long ball played ahead for Castellanos. Controls it with his chest. Trying to make a turn. Castellanos grabbed by Nekas. No whistle. You can see a handful of shirt there from the Naples United defender. Now Tenorio. He's on the front foot now for Naples. But right in the right spot again, Mishak Jerome.
And you can see the game plan right away for the Armada. Get Castellanos and get there, get hard the ball, high up the field, challenge Nekas and Garabsov, two center backs with a yellow card, both physical center backs, and to stop Gebhard or Castellanos. And have to do exactly what Nekas just did there, grab a jersey. And once again, referee Schwartz is right on top of the play, and I'm not really sure why he's not calling some of those things. Referees have a tendency to try to even out the second half, Cole. I know it's an unbiased tendency, but they do have a tendency to do that. And right now, he's allowing Naples United to kind of get away with a little bit more.
Kilduff, I think, got stepped on in the hamstring there.
Yeah.
Here is Tenorio. Gives it off for Tobin. Taken away by Jacksonville Castellanos. Now Yuma.
Yuma's patience. He just loves to settle the game back down. Every time it's a little bit too fast. So he lost the possession there, but he's just the kind of player that he is. He wants the ball to his feet. He wants to settle back and trust his center backs with possession.
And he worked for it, able to combine with Banks to dispossess Tenorio. And now here comes Jacksonville again. Castellanos couldn't control it. Correa, the Naples captain, who hasn't seen much of the ball tonight. Now a free kick coming for Jacksonville as Doyle was fouled. 5 minutes into the second half, and things getting a little chippy here. We should update you from Miami. 73rd minute, Miami still leading 4-0 over Boca Raton despite being down a man. Sharpie battling for it. Got shoved by Valadares.
And I think that's the right call. Valadares did not make a play of the ball. He just went to Sharpie. He could have just shielded the ball and protected it to going out of bounds. He decided to make it a wrestling match rather than a soccer game. And the assistant referee on that side allowed it to go.
Tenorio continuing to jaw now at the assistant referee. Anybody in a red shirt is fair game right now for Tenorio.
Yeah.
And a few in a dark blue shirt as well.
And I really don't understand why. I mean, I feel like it's definitely in the second half, Naples is getting a little bit more of a pass. It's a good Naples United team. If they just stay above it, they have a chance to get back into this game.
There's some pushing and shoving in front of the goal. Kilduff being called over. Blanco, the goalkeeper, getting in front of Kilduff. And temper's getting heated now. Schwartz, the referee, backs off. He appears to be willing to let things get figured out by the players right now. I think it was Gebhard who got pushed down. And Yuma trying to be the calmer head here.
There's a lot of unnecessary actions. The referee tried to talk to the captains of the team. Tempers continue to flare up a little bit.
He's got the yellow card out of his pocket.
And both sides just got to keep their cool heads to there. You see continue to happen.
Kilduff has gotten a yellow card.
And Tenorio does not agree with any call that's happening tonight.
Yuma is holding court between three Naples players with Schwartz right there, the referee.
Interesting, Yuma being a peacemaker. Oftentimes, he's the instigator at the same time.
Just about to say.
You know, but he understands how to play the game. He instigates enough, but he doesn't want to see the game get out of hand. He's a veteran player.
Here's Connor Doyle now for the corner for Jacksonville. A low screamer redirected out, and Naples can carry it free. Back heel to Tenorio, who overran it just a bit. Connor Doyle came back. Tenorio holding the foot up like it's a piece of evidence.
Well, he's asking for cards now, and I don't want to continue to beat a dead horse, but a lot off the ball stuff going on, a lot of unnecessary. It's a game that's been aggressive, it's been a physical game, but a good game nonetheless. Armada players have to rise above it. They have a playoff to play on Wednesday. They have the lead. For all intents and purposes, this is Naples United's last game, so they have nothing to lose after this, Cole. Armada have a lot to play for, and they need all their players if they want to make a run and beat Miami United, which they haven't beat them all season long.
Valadares to restart for Naples United. Sends one toward Brian Holt, and the Armada keeper handles it with two hands. He'll quickly outlet. Here comes Mikey Melvin out for Jacksonville. Now Kilduff. Now you don't want to see something happen to Jacksonville like we're hearing about happening in Miami with one of the top players, with Kilduff on a yellow card now.
Well, absolutely, and that's why I mean you have the lead. You're far from securing the win just yet. But all of a sudden, something silly, something off the play that maybe you didn't even initiate, but you were there.
Now Gebhardt pushed, and the foul signaled by the assistant referee.
Yeah, Neckes just goes with his elbow behind the back. They're not making plays on the ball at the moment.
And Tenorio came right up into Connor Doyle, who is going to try to restart it. And I think Matthew Schwartz, as much as anything, enough is enough with a theatrics from Tenorio, who continues to bark. And if he's not careful, he's going to get a second yellow card here very quickly. Tenorio has lost his cool and then some. Kilduff says, all right, Yuma. Hand over there. So Tenorio in the 56th minute with the yellow card.
Well, it's a shame because Tenorio is such a good player. We've seen him he's got great skill set, physical, technical. He's been a difference maker when he has played, but he's been more interested today. We've called more his name more because of theatrics off the ball than on the ball. And that wasn't even his foul. He came from late. That was Neca's aggressive foul from behind. Just have to rise above in there. Armada, if that's how Naples is going to want to play, Armada have to be better than this.
Connor Doyle serves it in. Punched away. Castellanos tried to send it in. It was directed back out by the Naples defense. Now Yuma tried to get it to Castellanos. David Walter came over for Naples to play it out. It'll be a throw-in for Jacksonville here in the 57th minute.
This is the perfect time. You know, people argue, should a soccer game ever have a bit of a timeout, even if it's a one-minute timeout? Perfect time for Mark Lowry to call a timeout, bring his team in and say, listen, you have to rise above it. You can't get into their game. They have nothing to play for if they lose this game. So they're going to try everything. Try to get that equalizer, make you uncomfortable. Trying to get a red card if they can.
Here's Sharpie playing one out wide. Tenorio running onto it for Naples United. Doyle went right by him and picked his pocket. And then sent away. Boy, what a move there by Connor Doyle. Yuma rising for it. Meshack Jerome now. Now here's Tobin with Tenorio making the run down the left. Tenorio back on the ball for the moment.
This is a very good Naples United team. They have a lot of great players. You can see why they're finishing fourth in the league right now and really close to making a playoff spot.
It's interesting that based on the number of teams in different conferences within the NPSL, in some places, fourth place makes the postseason. This is a smaller conference, so it's just three, but there are a lot of teams who will make the postseason, I would suppose, in the NPSL, who Naples United would match up very favorably with. Kilduff rising for it. Now Castellanos to Yuma. Now Gebhardt.
It's a good play from Castellanos and Gebhardt there.
Banks tried to go over the top, but a little too much on it. And Blanco able to handle it for Naples United. As we near the hour mark, it's been a feisty affair here. Pretty much from the opening whistle, the Armada have had by far the better chances and lead 1-0.
It's been an entertaining game. Second half got a little bit chippy here. You can see that all cards are on the table for the teams now.
Here's Mikey Melvin. Melvin going to carry it all the way. Sharpie looking for somebody on the cross. And just beats it right over the top of everybody through the box and out.
And he did have Kieran queued off and Derek Gebhardt in the box early. Great, lovely run from Mikey Melvin, just fighting through the physicality of NECA. Grobson, two very physical center backs for Naples United. It's a bit of a giveaway there from Wesley Sharpie. You want to do more with. You want to get the ball into the box. You want to get into your center forward's heads. At least give it a chance for a knockdown.
Update from Miami. Thomas Greco on a counterattack, able to find Ariel Martinez for Miami FC, who finishes to make it a 5-0 Miami FC lead over Boca. So, with 9 minutes of regulation time remaining, you can put that one in the books. Miami FC will have the top seed in the NPSL Sunshine Conference playoffs, and they'll play on Saturday against the winner of Jacksonville and Miami United. Question remains, where will that match be played? If the Armada hold on here, another foul on Naples United, this one on João Correa, the captain. If the result holds as it is here, the match will be here at Hodges Stadium on Wednesday night at 7 o'clock, and that game will be broadcast on Channel 4.
I think we see another crack of Mishak Dronfman. He's feeling good about himself tonight. Free kicks oftentimes are so much about confidence. And we know this seems like a far distance for most, but it's definitely within his range.
Right within the Jerome zone. He scored from just a little closer than this in the first half. Mishak Jerome, another blast. And oh, sent Blanco sprawling on a ball that was just cutting away from the goalkeeper and missed just wide.
Yeah, I said this looks like far for most, but that's right within his wheelhouse. And Blanco stretched out as far as he could. And the ball just missed the right post. Now the game is starting to settle back a little bit. Armada have to continue to press and not allow Naples United. They have Armada have the deeper roster. They have a lot more depth here. You're playing at home. You got the lead. Don't allow Naples United to get comfortable in possession.
Will be interesting to see what kind of substitutions Mark Lowry opts for. He does have some experience on the bench with the likes of Christian Silva. He's got young pace with Camilo Portilla.
When you mentioned two guys that have made a difference for their Armada during their time, gotten a lot of minutes this season so far. Portilla more of an attacking player with plenty of speed, very similar to Derek Gebhardt. Can play multiple positions internally on the outside.
And then Silva, more of a possession player, central midfielder type. This one over the top for Wes Sharpie. Castellanos, nice bit of skill. Couldn't keep his feet. And the flag is up for a foul from the assistant referee on the near side. For a moment, I thought he was calling offside, but it was a foul on Castellanos.
It was another foul on Castellanos. And once again, if that's Neca or Garopson, if he's not on a yellow card already, and that's Neca's, that's a yellow card. I mean, that's a third yellow card in the second half that he got away with.
And another shot, perhaps coming from the Jerome zone.
Jimenez continues to play this aggressive, which is what a yellow card in the first half makes you have to wonder as a center back. Do you lay off? Do you let players go by you?
Three-man wall, putting their lives in their own hands here. Jerome deflected out in front. Wasn't cleared cleanly, but then Tenorio able to get past Mishak and well tackled by Yuma coming back for it. Yuma then is spilled. Kilduff maintains possession. They play on. Out wide for J.C. Banks. Banks tripped up. Right at the edge of the box. It'll be a free kick for Jacksonville. It'll be a mini corner.
Well, I'll tell you what, the way Mishak Jerome is hitting free kicks right now, everything on frame, everything with power, just let him hit that 1-2 from the corner. Straight shot. And he can hit one from halfway line right now, Cole, and I have a good indication that it's going to go on frame. Missed opportunity for their motto on the last free kick. They have to follow that up, knowing that Mishak has that kind of power, difficult to handle. There's got to be a player there ready to tap that in. I think they're all waiting for the ball to just go in the back of the net. They have to follow that play up.
Connor Doyle. Try an in-swinger here. Sends it along the ground. Kilduff saved by Blanco.
Wow, what a beautiful play. What a great run by Kilduff. Great service by Doyle.
Doyle sends it in again. All the way over for Derek Gebhardt. Gebhardt had the ball tackled away nicely by Naples United. A risky slide tackle in the box for Naples. But it worked out. Tenorio. Watched by Castellanos. 65th minute. I would say four top opportunities for Jacksonville. Well, you would say top flight chances. One of them found the net with Meshack Jerome, only created as a top-flight chance because it was Meshack striking the free kick.
Yeah, a lot more clear-cut chances in the first half. There's been a scrappier second half, but Armada still having the better of the chances. Naples United really not having anything concrete on goal.
Castellanos plays one ahead for Gebhardt. Offside flag comes up. It was a delayed flag, but it was the right call.
Yeah, much better from there. Gebhardt, they're playing off the shoulder of the center backs, trying to get in behind. A lot of what they might have tried to do in the beginning of the second half. Now with Naples United really screaming for a goal, trying to push forward as much as possible. It's going to leave a lot of holes in the back.
Castellanos continues to work hard.
It's a perfect game for Carmelo Portillo to come in with his skill set, making people have to tackle him. Two center backs lined up with yellow cards. A very physical game.
Gebhardt onside this time. Doesn't have a lot of help coming until just now. Gebhardt all the way across the box. JC Banks tracks it down. Banks awaiting help. Here's Melvin. Mikey Melvin. Nobody in particular making the run. Castellanos keeps it in. He was tripped up on the edge of the box. No whistle there.
It's a good defensive play from Correa there. Those Armada getting a lot of success out wide, but those crosses just coming in too floated into the back post. All the runners are on the near post. But great run from Mikey Melvin, just knowing, just recognizing and respecting his own speed, pushing past.
Tried to get it through to Gebhardt, but couldn't control it. McInerney steps in front of it for Jacksonville now. And now Gebhardt again. Tenorio comes to mark Gebhardt, who draws a lot of light blue shirts around him. Three Naples defenders take the ball away.
Yeah, there Gebhardt has just continued to play his game. Connect underneath in the middle third, and then get high again where you're most dangerous. No reason to dribble or try to get past people in the middle third. Just give it to your guys that know how to do that job and get yourself high in threatening positions, because he's been brilliant tonight on that.
I see Keita taking off his warm-up shirt. The 35-year-old veteran, all-time leading goal scorer for Jacksonville, might be getting the call here as a sub for Jacksonville. Interesting move for Mark Lowry.
Yeah, I'd be interesting to see where he fits Keita. He's more of a true striker at this stage in his career, more inside the box. I think he's seen the opportunities. He's still got a couple sprints to him. I think he sees the opportunity over the top and how much space Naples United has given you. And if he wants the ball to fall on anyone's foot inside the box, Kate is the guy. Interesting to see if he comes in for Derek Gebhardt.
Here's Castellanos. Floats one toward the back post, headed out. It'll be a corner kick for the Armada. It would make sense that Gebhardt might be the guy when you start talking about the substitution. You could also see a change in formation if you have somebody like JC Banks. Corner kick coming. Doyle sends it on the way. Headed out by Correa for Naples. And then cleared out.
Veteran player from Yuma, just calming it down, trusting your goalkeeper. He's good with his feet. Almost plays like a safety back there, Cole, just cleaning everything up.
Final score from Miami. Miami FC 5, Boca Raton FC 0. It's over. Miami has clinched the top seed. They will play on Saturday at home against the winner of Jacksonville and Miami United, which will be a Wednesday night affair. Again, if this result holds, the Armada will host that match Wednesday at 7. Kilduff after Connor Doyle had a little tug on a Naples player. And here comes the sub. It appears it will be Keita. Coming in for J.C. Banks.
Coming in, number 22,
And I think this might either be a formation change at this late in the stage in the game with 20 minutes left, or personnel change. You see Keita coming in for J.C. Banks, but going up more centrally.
And Gebhard going over to that left wing now.
Yeah, which is where he has played most of the season as a left wing back. Got to make sure he's got enough legs to recover, because this system requires a left wing back to come back a lot defensively.
So we may see more of a 4-2-3-1, do you think, here?
I think defensively that's what you're going to see. I think offensively you're still going to release Gebhard on the left wing. Castellanos playing inside, but more on the right-hand side of the central midfield. I think you'd expect Wesley Sharpie to be a little bit more reserved and not get forward as much with the 1-0 lead. But I think Coach Lowry sees how important the second goal is to really put this game away. While Naples United really haven't threatened Brian Holt's goal in the second half, you know that it's only one chance away from something happening. So the second goal is crucial for Armada at this point in the game.
Kilduff got it to Gebhard. Now back to the captain. It'll be a throw-in for Jacksonville from right at the end of the Armada bench.
And I'll tell you what, with Keita's experience with two center backs on a yellow card call, he's just going to freeze those two guys the whole time. He's going to try to get something drawn inside the box, maybe another penalty kick.
Here's Keita with his first touch. The Ghanaian veteran. Here's Kilda. Rather Sharpie. And another corner kick coming for Jacksonville.
And right away, Keita have an influence in the game. Just a different technical attributes that he has, where Derek Gebhard is more of that straight runner, get the ball in behind and threatening. Keita is so good with his feet. He knows how to play with his back to the goal. And it's a great pass for the ball, as you saw on that last play. It's going to improve our modest possession in the final third a little bit here with Keita on the field. And you still have this the pace of Gebhard all wide.
Keita, certainly not a physical presence on corners, not a tall player, but he knows the tricks. This one driven in, a header. Keita got his foot to it, and he scores! Another goal for Keita, the all-time leading goal scorer for Jacksonville. Does it again.
Well, and right on cue, as we're talking about his importance onto the game, hats off to Coach Lowry there. Just as he drew up, Keita has an influence on the corner kick. Little flick from McInerney. Great little flick set play. And Keita, calm, cool, and collected in the back post, just really passes it in. And as Blanco tried to get there, pushes the ball into the side netting.
16 career goals for the Armada for that end, Keita. And 120 career goals in his professional career.
And you can see there, just a veteran player. Just get the points to me inside the six-yard box. I know what to do with it.
We were joking a bit at halftime watching him out there. He still has the touch. He still has the deft little moves with the foot. Maybe doesn't run as much as he did when he first joined the Armada, but knows where he has to be, and he was in exactly the right place at the right time there.
Well, this is a perfect role for him. If the Armada are down a goal and they need someone to chase the ball down and really apply a lot of defensive pressure, that's not the guy to put in. Maybe a Portilla, maybe somebody else, you know, Brian Bemet with a lot more physical presence. But you're up a goal, you're really just trying to secure that lead and maybe put it open the curtain, and here comes Keita.
When Keita was first signed by the Armada, one of the first big signings the club made, might have been, you know, the first four or five players who were signed. You start looking at his background as a goal scorer, and everywhere he's gone, he's led clubs in goals scored. He's played in leagues all over the world. Switzerland, the Middle East.
Oh, he produces.
Africa.
Yeah, absolutely, he produces. We've seen him over time and time again wearing his Armada uniform just produce goals.
He had signed with a club in Saudi Arabia where he had played previously in that country. And when he got there, the club was a whole different situation than what had been presented to him. And so he came back to Jacksonville and was training on his own, and occasionally he'd be out when the Armada in the off season needed some bodies, and with some of the uncertainty about what the roster might look like with the change in leagues. Keita was there as they start to work on Derek Gebhardt. And sometimes it's location, location, location. Keita's certainly familiar, having been here the first 2 years of the club. And lo and behold, a roster spot for him with the Armada became available. And he says he's living his American dream now.
Well, he was always such a good club leader, too, a good locker room guy. Even when he was at his best physically and on top of his game, you couldn't go anywhere without players just absolutely raving about what kind of person he was, what kind of leader he was to the younger players in the locker room. So you see now he's in town, team needs some extra bodies. Why not call on the service of Keita? And if he's going to give you one thing all season long, it's to put a game away, heading into the playoffs and secure a home game for the first time in the playoffs. It's an investment.
Armada substitution. Well played. Coming in is number 15, Portilla, for number 27.
Camilo Portilla Gebhardt. Coming in, and they'll give Derek Gebhardt the rest of the night off. Well earned with the creation of chances for Derek Gebhardt, and you get pace for pace here. And remember, the Armada have to turn around and play on Wednesday night. It looks like they won't have to travel if this result stands, but you'd like to give some of these legs a little bit of a chance to start the recovery process as soon as possible if it's needed. And Gebhardt, as you know, a little slighter build than some others.
When they just played midweek down in Fort Lauderdale as well. So it's a lot of travel, midweek games for all these teams. So having a proper depth and in preparation for the next game is super important.
Now Keita. Nifty little move again. And Keita wins a throw-in for Jacksonville.
You know, as a player, Derek Gebhardt has got to be frustrated with himself because he got kicked all over the field tonight. He probably feels like it's a frustrating game for him, but I guarantee you his teammates will hug him and will applaud him in the locker room after the game because he moved and he terrorized this Naples United back line and allows opportunities for other guys to come, like the free kick of Meshack, PKs, and other opportunities.
Kilduff kicked from behind. One captain, João Correa, taking on another, Kieran Kilduff. Quick restart for Jacksonville. Yuma. Out wide now for Mikey Melvin. You see Keita drifting back a little deeper. A little one touch. With Yuma and Keita, you've got a couple of guys who have both played in La Liga. Castellanos out wide now for Sharpie. Sharpie swings one in, punched out with both hands by Blanco. Keita was one of the players that Castellanos referenced when I talked to him yesterday about veterans he's looked for. Keita taken down right outside of the box. Another free kick coming for Jacksonville. Keita might want to take this one himself.
Yeah, and another foul from Nekas. There's such a thing as accumulation of fouls as well. But you can just see his presence up there, how he holds on to the ball so well. You think Meshack Jones is going to let anybody else take this free kick after how he's been playing?
Keita looked back at him.
Meshack's like, just get out of here. Let me get
this. This is mine.
He is salivating at another opportunity to put this on frame.
And both guys with international experience playing for their countries. And it continues to be contentious.
Just a lot of off the play stuff. Naples United seem to kind of have come up here with a bit of a chip on their shoulders. And we've known some of their Armada players like Yuma and Meshack Jerome not to back down from any confrontation.
And remember, Naples won earlier this year. Just, a week and a half ago.
Yeah, and you can see why. They're a good team. A lot of talent on the field.
And I think there's sort of an underlying thought from some of the NPSL teams that have been here that these teams coming in from the NASL, this one's deflected over the top. Corner kick for Jacksonville coming. I think there's a bit of a thought that, you know, perhaps these NASL teams are interlopers. And teams like Miami FC, the Armada, New York Cosmos playing in a different division.
Of course. Well, it's always trying to take take down Goliath, right? Everyone wants to feel like they're the underdog, and they want to beat up on the bigger guys, and that's Armada, that's Miami FC, and that's Cosmos. So if you have an opportunity to take a bite at them.
All the way through for Keita again, and cleared out. Meshack Jerome will send a moon ball. Keita looked like he was trying to measure it, trying to sneak in underneath it, and carried out now by Naples United. Wilfredo Alvarez for Naples has taken off the warm-up, and he may be ready to sub in. Nifty little move by Yuma with a spinorama. Now Connor Doyle. Castellanos back to Doyle. Didn't hit it cleanly. And you can see from his reaction that Connor felt like he had a good opportunity there.
Boy, that's a beautiful bit of play from Jacksonville Armada there. You see the experience of Yuma, who's about to get tackled, just let the ball go underneath his legs, continue to play. Good little combo up on top of the box from Castellanos and Connor Doyle. Connor just didn't get enough off on that shot. But good composure from their mod. You can see Keita's influence substitution, not only on the goal, but his influence on the game has been tremendous so far.
Wilfredo Alvarez on. Number 28, replacing Franco Leonhardt for Naples United. And Christian Silva comes on for Connor Doyle for the Armada. Those are the substitutions here with less than 10 minutes regulation time remaining. There's Silva getting an early touch. Meshack Jerome sends one along the ground.
Yeah, Silva will bring a little bit of more experience into the midfield. Some more legs. He'll sit a little bit more next to Yuma, where Connor Doyle like to get forward.
Naples feeling perhaps a bit desperate now. 8 minutes regulation time remaining in their season.
Okay, you'd expect Naples to start throwing caution to the wind here now and getting some extra numbers forward. Might have to be careful not to give up anything sloppy here.
A goal would change this game in a hurry, one way or another. Now Tenorio. They play on. Tenorio trying to get around Meshack Jerome. Mikey Melvin coming in support. And not much comes of it.
And Tenorio, really good player. Just seems to, at times, play on an island, play by himself.
Pull out your 50-50 raffle tickets. Here's your winner.
Brian Hole will have no rush, getting his ball back in play.
Raffle. 2-3-7-1-4-2-6.
Pretty quiet night from Brian Holt in the back line. He's done. He had one really good save on a counterattack in the first half that kept the game even right after the PK miss by Kildoff. But besides that, he's just really managing his back line and making sure those guys are sharp and connected the entire time.
If the result holds, it would be Holt's fourth clean sheet in the last six games. You will win a lot of contests when you don't give up goals.
Well, we always talk about goals changing games. If you're not getting scored a whole lot, then the game plan for you can stay consistent. It can stay the same.
Little flick on header from Kilduff. Yuma comes to it. Now Silva. Back to Meshack Jerome. The Armada not going to be over anxious, you wouldn't think, on the attack. They'll take their opportunity. Portilla coming back for it. And all the way back to Holt. Yuma, McInerney.
What a luxury to have a goalkeeper that can, under pressure, hit penetrating passes, break lines, find your holding mid, which a guy like Yuma just knows exactly where to be as a support player. Not come too tight, not to bring in a defender. Just play right off the shoulder of guys. But that's all well said and done from a center midfield. But if you don't have a goalkeeper or a back line that can find those passes, then you're running a whole lot. And Yuma's a player that covers a lot of ground, but he rarely sprints on the field because he just knows exactly where to be. And you have a guy like Brian Hole, just like here. He can hit a 40-50-yard ball on the dime.
Sharpie wrestled and then kicked. by Valadere. Another substitute coming up for Naples.
Like to thank you for your support this season. And don't forget, here is the 50-50 100.
Andres Vasquez will sub in.
237-1426. Again, 237-1426.
At the next opportunity.
Please report to the 100 by tent located on the main concourse area to redeem your winnings.
Doesn't seem like anybody wants to come off.
No, I was going to say, maybe they haven't decided. And now Mitchell Tobin will jog over in that direction.
Naples United substitution coming onto the field is number 18 for number 20.
So Tobin off. And Vasquez on. Long ball over the top. Naples able to win the second ball. Castellanos trying to create a turnover here, continuing to work. Well, look at the work rate on the former UNF Osprey.
That's something that we've talked about. He's been good on the ball. He's been good defensively. But probably the thing that highlights him the most, kind of player he is, he's just relentless with his work ethic. He doesn't stop. I tell you every week, Cole, I've had the pleasure to coach against Joshua Castellanos for 3 years during his time at UNF, and he's just a fantastic player, always has an influence in the game. And it's a pleasure to see him even now continue his career.
Keita took a tumble. Tenorio carries it out for Naples United. As Section 904 starts the thunderclap. Iceland's most popular export since Bjork. There was a thunderclap off the foot of Meshack Jerome in the first half. In stoppage time, they gave the Armada the 1-0 lead. Here's Portilla working for it.
Correction for Naples United substitution. Number 18 came on the field for number 11.
And in the second half, Keita's 73rd minute goal, helping give Jacksonville a little more breathing room.
And ever since then, the game really has settled down a little bit. Naples have made a couple attempts to try to get forward.
Kilduff got kicked. You don't want anything happening here late in the contest.
When Kilduff's on a yellow card as well, so you don't want to make sure that there's no reaction to what he's doing. He doesn't get involved in a play.
And that's Moyano who got the yellow card. Moyano, 5 goals this year, including one against the Armada last week that won for Naples United, but he's been a non-factor today.
Oh, McInerney, Meshack Jerome, and Mikey Melvin have had a great defensive game. Wesley Sharpie comes back and completes that back line of 4 defensively. Sharpie does so much work because you see him out wide as a right winger, right wing back. But I think McInerney has had a really good day so far.
Brian Beamant's over there
Naples
stretching.
United substitution coming onto the field is number 15 for number 3.
And now Raul Sanchez Ferrer comes on for Jose Valadere. So that's the last numbered player that we know of for Naples United.
You can see the Armada try to kill this game with possession, make Naples United have to defend a whole lot, open up the space in behind.
Sharpie heads it back toward the middle. Kilduff continuing to chase after it. Rather, that's Castellanos, to no surprise. Kilduff rising for that one. Two Naples players come together. And it's played out for a Jacksonville throw. Bement will come in for Castellanos, who has certainly earned a chance to sit for a moment or two.
Well, I'll tell you what, I don't know if Castellanos is in the voting for MVP of the year, but certainly best newcomer of the year. Well, there's a couple that were really good for their Armada this year, Mikey Melvin. I'll tell you what, Castellanos continues to grow as a player from game to game, And I just think he's one of the most influential players on his team. And if you ask any of the veteran players like Yuma, Meshack, Jerome, Keita, they can't speak enough on this young man.
There's Brian Beeman who comes on. Former Puerto Rico FC player.
Brian Beeman is really a forward, but I think Coach Lahr is looking for legs right now. Guys are going to continue to press, not allow Naples to get back into the game, but he's going to come in into that attacking midfield role just to lock things down.
3 minutes of stoppage time now. We are into stoppage time. And the Armada are 3 minutes away from earning a home playoff game. The first time in club history they will play in the postseason. And they'll host a game on Wednesday. It'll be a 7 o'clock kickoff here at Hodges Stadium. And we'll also broadcast that game on Channel 4.
You see Kerry Kindle off there trying to hold the ball into the corner. He's had a good game. Switch roles a little bit, not being the guy centrally inside the box, but coming out and playing more almost an attacking midfield role at times, just as a second forward.
Here's Kilduff in the box trying to maintain possession.
So I'll tell you what, he would have liked to get the PK early in the first half back. Been a good way to get his momentum going into the playoffs. It's the work ethic. You know, it's beautiful to see the how modern the game has become, where forwards, attackers, the wingers, they have to be hardworking players. You look at someone like Kildoff and Castellanos, Derek Gebhardt. There's no walking on the field. Defensively, they come back, they support, they help.
Just over a minute left. Yuma detected for a foul.
It's a good professional foul on the counterattack for Yuma. Coach Lahr is going to be really pleased with this team's performance tonight. It wasn't perfect by any means. A lot of missed opportunities in the first half. And game got super chippy in the second half, but team kept their cool. And a super sub, veteran player Keita, does a fantastic job putting the game away for them.
Two of the guys who have spent a lot of time in an Armada kit scoring here in this contest. Long-time Armada players in Keita and Meshack Jerome. Beeman battling for it. Taken away by Portilla, who gets kicked. Closing seconds of the regular season for the Armada and for Naples. The season will continue for Jacksonville with a home playoff game on Wednesday. Portilla will take it toward the flag. How much more time left in this one? There it is, the end of the regular season. And for the Armada, they clinch the second seed in the NPSL playoffs in the Sunshine Conference. So Wednesday night, 7 o'clock, Jacksonville Armada against Miami United. Jacksonville will try to beat Miami United for the first time this year with a meeting in the waiting against Miami FC, a very professional way to put away this final game and earn that second seed, Mauricio.
Yeah, very, very solid performance from the Armada from back to front, goalkeeper hole, made the saves when he needed to make and allowed the team to just continue to grow. And when you have players like Keita that can come off the bench and make the difference as he did, Coach Lahr, as you see there on the screen, a lot to be proud of his squad tonight. And great momentum going into Wednesday against a Miami United team. That's going to be a very difficult task call.
Well, let's take just a moment to look ahead before we call it a night. Again, United beat Jacksonville in the U.S. Open Cup. The Armada have not had an opportunity to beat them this year. They've had a couple of draws in NPSL play. What do you expect Wednesday night?
Well, I think that's the one game that it's marked on their calendar that they want to get on off the books for this season. And Miami United, a good team, a team with a lot of talent, a lot of veteran players that have proven to be difficult tasks for their Armada. I think they feel confident playing at home. They're expecting a big crowd here on Wednesday. It's been good games, been good matchups against that opposition. And it's going to be a matter of one goal game that's going to differentiate the winner to the loser in that game.
Well, we will see you at 7 o'clock on Wednesday night here at Hodges Stadium as the Armada launch into the postseason. Jacksonville today, a 2-0 winner over Naples United to close out the regular season as the second seed in the Sunshine Conference. For Mauricio Ruiz and our entire crew here at Hodges Stadium, Cole Pepper saying thanks for watching Jacksonville Armada Soccer. Have a great night, everybody.